Welcome back to the third part of my little tutorial on the basic modeling techniques in AnswerSet programming. In the second part, we've been concerned with improving the very basic yet natural encoding given in the first part. We try to improve it in terms of grounding as well as in terms of solving, that is, search. This can, however, go both ways, as I want to show you in this third part. To this end, I prepared a corrupted encoding or a corrupted version of the basic encoding given to you in the first part. This is given on the right-hand side. So this encoding is more or less identical with the first basic encoding, except that I was so mean to introduce a third argument to the queen predicate, which has no purpose at all, which simply blows up combinatorics in terms of grounding and then, of course, as a consequence, in terms of solving. And in the end, well, after solving the problem with three arguments, I just project the first two arguments out and thus have a nice solution to my n queens puzzle. Of course, on the way to get this solution, I introduce a lot of redundancy, and of course in this example here, this is pretty obvious, but this must not be so obvious in the general case. Let's nonetheless see what is the impact of this and just ground it a little bit. So let's just take the commands I've prepared over here. Now this is what we get when grounding the very basic encoding from the first part. On the 14 queens puzzle, we get 8,581 rules. If we take the advanced encoding that we looked at in the second part, we get 494. Well, not rules, because we also have the symbol table inside. And just to get an idea, and here is now the corrupted encoding. Well, first of all, you even saw that it took a little bit longer, and you saw that we really screwed up. We have now more than 100,000 rules in the program. So, as you see, one can say that even this here is sort of declarative, except that you spot immediately that there is this third argument which serves no purpose, but it's declarative in a particular sense, and that's what I want to make precise as the moral, more or less, of this third talk here. And this is to discuss declarativity versus scalability. In fact, I would even claim that all three encodings are declarative in the sense that they completely abstract from the solving mechanism that is used. In this respect, my definition of declarativity for ASP is that ASP does separate a problem's representation from the algorithm used for solving it, but what ASP does not do, it does not separate a problem's representation from the induced combinatorics. So if your problem representation contains a lot of redundancy, as we've seen with the corrupted encoding, you cannot escape the resulting combinatorics. So this is definitely something that we have to face. And another problem that is still there, but that is actually well known, and this is nothing specific to ASP, but something more general, it also includes SAT or PB solving, is that modern ASP solvers that rely on Boolean constraint technology are rather sensitive to the individual search parameters. Of course, this is also natural. We deal with search problems, NP problems, and the better your heuristics is in mimicking the ultimate oracle, the faster you get to your solution. Anyway, there's one big homework we face as a community, and this is source code optimization. So we have to come up with programs that take an ASP encoding and translate it into another ASP encoding that is equivalent, but has the appropriate combinatorics for the problem and eliminates all sorts of redundancies. And this, I think, is one of the big challenges we face as a community. Okay, now let's complete this third part and prepare you for the fourth part, where we will be dealing with even more advanced encodings. Well, until then, stay tuned. Bye-bye.